Well, I preached a different sermon on this text in 2014 when the first part of it came up in the three-year lectionary rotation way back then. For those of you who were not here or for some reason cannot recall that sermon, it was, I'm sure, brilliant. I've long been drawn to this text, the lesson that Bobby read so well, because it really is brilliant. The lectionary reading actually stops at verse 7, but I added the rest of the chapter because the whole story is compelling and powerful and is often not heard in church these days. And the core of that story is taken from an ancient poem version found in Judges 5, which is believed by scholars to be one of the very oldest stories in all the Bible. You see, the story for eons has been important. It's spoken to God's people for thousands of years. It can speak to us too, but it needs some unpacking for full effect. And first, I want to remind us that the Bible and much of its time, the places, much of its culture was heavily influenced by a decidedly patriarchal world. These influences intentionally diminished and held down and oppressed women. And this makes the courage and accomplishment of women in the story remarkable. It makes the recording of their heroic act quite astonishing. There was a time in the history of the Hebrew people, it appears the oldest of times in the Bible, when women had power and respect. They led armies and generals and saved the Hebrew people. Women of all strata were not just provided opportunities to be heroic, but were heralded and remembered and recorded as such. That this old, old story survived time and remains with us today speaks volumes as to the real value and worth and respect of women that not only God clearly has, but God's people should have. The story has been passed down and women upheld and honored as heroes, not only because Deborah and Jael were heroic, which surely they were, but also because women are in reality upheld and honored by most friends and family, even if not by the ethos of patriarchal tainted cultures. And again, the story records a time when the ethos of the culture was different. It tells us it can be different. Women can be honored and respected and leaders and heroes and should be treated as such, not abused. Like we've heard all month long in the news. And we know that to be true. And so does God. And in this story, we find it deeply embedded in the Bible itself. We are reminded in the book of Judges that before Israel was led by kings, the Hebrew people were led by what were called judges. After Moses and Joshua, and before Saul and David, we're told in the book of Judges about a series of heroes who help or lead God's people. Basically, the judges are people who show different types of leadership skills in pre-monarchy times. As the Anchor Bible Dictionary notes, the title Judges reflects a public activity and or office of the leaders, especially in a time of hardship or oppression. Story. We can hear that Deborah, while not royalty, is pretty close to full leadership as can be. She is portrayed as a prophetess, military leader, decision maker, and law judge. She's the only judge in Judges who does all these things. She's the only prophet named among. Deborah is notably shown as a very strong woman with no negative connotations to that. She's a leader in the time of crisis. So the Canaanites are well-armed enemies and led by a very capable, feared general Sisera. It's a time when able people from any strata of the culture were allowed to contribute to the community's survival, and Deborah have surfaced to the top. She's who the Hebrews come to for trusted leadership. She's who very successfully commands the community response to the military threat. The story is awesome alone. The fact that it conveys the message that when a community is allowed to rely on a woman to use her God-given gifts, everyone in the community benefits. Our lectionary reading from Judges 4 is, as I said, based on the first and oldest, very, very old version of the story found in the next chapter, Judges 5, which is the poem that Deborah sings. Judges 5 is believed to have been written shortly after the real battle, way, way back in the 12th century BC. How cool is that? One of the oldest, if not the oldest story in the Bible, remembers and records a woman playing a major heroic leadership role. And if that's not enough to get excited about, the story does not just lift up and honor a Hebrew female leader. As we heard, a female elite is not the only hero. Jael, an alien Kenite woman, a lowlife to the culture, is also held up as valued and heroic. Indeed, it is into her hand that the enemy is delivered to fulfill Deborah's prophecy. Jael's story is, in some respects, an even more remarkable one than Deborah's. Jael has no lofty status in the culture. She's the wife of Heber the Kenite, a friend of an enemy oppressor of Israel. Those hearing the story back then would have known, too, that Jael's role as a wife included setting up tents, so she knows how to drive tent. As a wife, she would also have been expected to provide hospitality by greeting visitors and offering food and a place to sleep, as she does for Sisera. And there's also awful sex object mistreatment and abuse of women, akin to what we've been hearing lately in our own modern news. Going back to Deborah for a minute. Deborah, the Hebrew judge, proves her mettle wielding the same power men are given: allegiance, respect, leadership, and army. She's a superhero when given the superpowers that men aren't allowed to have. And in contrast, Jael matches, maybe even one upset, by proving her mettle, wielding only the limited powers that the Kenite clan, like patriarchies throughout history, have allowed women: homemaking skills, and have required women give as they are asked, commanded, or forced. Think about it. Jael, in the story, offers Sisera what men in power expect from women: seductive comfort, a blanket, warm milk, and doing what he requires. But once Sisera gets what he wants and is lulled to security and sleep, Jael kills him in a dreadfully violent fashion, using the skill of pig pounding that women in nomadic tent-centered home life acquire. It's amazingly remarkable that the story as a whole can be understood to have been written to purposefully praise a non-elite woman, an alien enemy, for cleverly finding a way to use what skills she was allowed to have to beat the brains of the enemy, literally and figuratively. With nothing but rudimentary skills, Jael uses non-superpowers to do what no male general or warrior in hand-to-hand combat could do. She conquered a Goliath of a man, Sisera. And I use that word Goliath to bring to mind David, who as a small team pulled off a similar victory with a slingshot, right? David also victoriously used what limited skills he had in combat. Jael did it in the Bible first, before David, and in close quarters. The story, as I said, is compelling. Cicero, a glorious general, is defeated on the battlefield by an elite female commander. He then evades the male powers and warriors of Israel on the ground, only to be captured by a non-elite woman who was able to dispatch him in hand-to-hand combat when no man was able to do it. I know that is powerful. All on its own, that's why I raised the story up, but I distrust patriarchy when it comes to what women and other non-elites can do and did. And so I wonder if, and I like to think that maybe the original historic event took place in a time when women had direct leadership and were allowed to do battle and acts of heroism in the defeat of an enemy. And actually, the story suggests and even evidences this. And it makes me wonder if perhaps Deborah might actually have been the general in command from the start, but in the retelling, the patriarchy washed that part out, it being too much to admit a woman was fully in charge and successful. And this is a bit more fanciful on my part. I wonder too if perhaps Jael was a female warrior who felled Sisera on a battlefield, or maybe even Deborah and Jael's acts were actually performed by one woman who also acted as a judge, and later a male-dominated system altered the story so that women would not get the idea that they too could be glorious leaders or defeat men in a supposedly man's world. I'm not saying that's the real story. I'm saying that it would not surprise me in the least if it were, especially since the older version in Judges 5 has Jael defeat and kill a standing up, not lying down, Sisera. And the layers added a nap and blanket and milk cast Sisera in a humiliating little child image curled up asleep and more easy to kill than a standing up able to fight warrior that Judges 5 suggests. And by the time Judges 4 is written, the story's already being refashioned to make Jael's feet less manly. So I wouldn't put it past patriarchal culture to also refashion the story in order to belittle an enemy male general, a lessening female victory in battle. Whether the story was as told or something more as I imagine, we'll never know. We do know that the power elites in male-dominated cultures treat women as second-class lesser beings, unable to lead and unable to be equal to or best men, and also as primarily their sex objects. And we know that we have this very ancient Bible story where, when examined, it defies the legitimacy and the validity of that treatment. Indeed, our lesson today can be heard to flat out undermine the patriarchy by honoring females as capable leaders and courageous heroes and equals to men and not their sex objects. And given a leadership, women are at least as capable as men to do it well. Our lesson today evidences God made it so. God lets it happen. Deborah's part in the story is Exhibit A, the evidence. It's evidence that this is true. It's a story which has been placed before God's people for thousands of years, proving women's worth. Jael's part in the story is Exhibit B. She evidences that it's not just women who are allowed to be elite and leaders that are able to be equal to or best men. Jael's amazing part in the story makes it clear that women of any stature or class can be as capable of men to get what needs to be done. Our lesson today evidences God made it so. God lets it happen. You see, women are of equal value as men. Period. God's people need to recognize that because God does. And let me close by asking, who in the story shows us how men in the culture and the male culture should act towards women? Barak. General Barak, right? He's a male general who's not afraid to go to a capable woman and seek and obtain her God-given gifts for leadership. Tellingly, Barak is not afraid to let the credit go to a woman when Deborah says Sisera will be delivered into the hands of a woman. Typically, people hear that to mean Deborah, but it literally means Jael. God ups the ante as this story unfolds with the unexpected evidence that women of all levels of society can do supposedly man's work. So we can hear General Barak acting as the hands and the feet and the voice of God by being today what we call an ally for women. He has this great attitude of not letting his male ego or patriarchal hoo-ha get in the way. Deborah commands his help. He wants the job done right and lets the best person do it. Gender is not a factor in his decision. He does not care if deserving women, the person who does the job, gets the credit. What matters is the result. And the result is Barak works with Deborah to defend the Hebrew people from a Canaanite king who has ruled over them for 20 years. And they're victorious. And that rule is broken by men and women working together using their God-given gifts while they answer God's call to treat each other respectfully and honorably, not as property, not as objects. And that's a good lesson that can obviously still teach us all today, 3,000 years later. May all God's people continue to learn